Now let's talk about a very simple type of neuron, which is called the perceptron. So here's what a perceptron does. The perceptron essentially takes in several inputs. Those are shown as X1 through X3 here. These are the inputs. And it produces a binary output or a decision. And the way it does this is that it takes the inputs and it multiplies the inputs with these weights that are shown here, W1 through W3, and then compares the weighted sum of the inputs with what's called a threshold or a bias B. And then, based on that comparison, puts out an output which is either a 0 or 1. So we have a perceptron which has weights WJ and a bias, a single bias B. And so this can be written as follows. You can write all the weights as a vector W, all the inputs as a vector X, and you have your bias which is B, and you take WX plus B, and if that happens to be less or equal to 0, the output of the perceptron is a 0, and if that happens to be greater than 0, the output is a 1. That's it. It's a very simple algorithm, so to speak. So now, let's take a look at this term right here, WX plus B. We'll call that Z. And so really, what the perceptron is doing is applying a function to Z. So as the inputs come in, you get a value for Z, and then you're going to apply a function to Z. And in the case of the perceptron, the function is very simple. If Z is less or equal to 0, the output is 0. If Z is greater than 0, the output is 1. So what is the function F then? Well, that function is a step function, or the Heaviside function. So in other words, the activation function of a perceptron is the step function. All right, so now let's take a look at what you can do with a single perceptron. Just a very simple example. Let's say you wanted to make the following decision, which is, will you go to the movies? And you want to make this decision based on three factors: the weather, whether you have company or not, and how close the theater is, proximity. So you have weather, company, and proximity. And so now you can build a perceptron to do this, and we need a little bit more information to decide what the weights and biases need to be in this case. So let's assume for a moment that the weather is the most important factor. That is, if the weather is bad, you're not going to the movies. So you can assign a relatively large weight for the weather and lower weights for the other two, company and proximity. So 4, 2, 2, say, for instance. And let's say that what you would like is to end up going to the movies only if the weather is good and at least one of the other two factors is also true or in favor. So for that, you can set a bias of -5 right here. And so that will assure that if any one of these two is in favor, and if the weather is good, that's when you're going to end up going to the movies. So let's see how that works. So let's say that the weather is bad. If the weather is bad, you have 1 times 2 plus 1 times 2, that's 4. 4 minus 5 is -1, which is less than 0, and therefore the output is 0, and therefore you will not go to the movies. Now, if the weather is good, and let's say you happen to have company, then you have 1 times 4, that's 4, plus 1 times 2, that's 2, that's equal to 6. 6 minus 5, the bias right here, is 1, that's greater than 0, and therefore the output is 1. So in this case, the decision is to go to the movies. Now let's take a closer look at what a single perceptron is doing. So here is a single perceptron, and let's say it has two inputs, X1 and X2, and let's say the weights are -2, both of them, and the bias is 3. So you have the activation, the output A is equal to the step function applied, the Heaviside function applied to Z, and what is Z? Z is -2X1, -2X2, plus 3. So let's look at this in the input space. The input space is the X1, X2 space. That's this right here. And in the input space, if you look at the right-hand side of this equation, we know that that's a straight line. Let's say that this is the straight line right here. So what's happening here is that if you have an x1, x2 that happens to either lie on the straight line or to the right of the straight line, in that case, z is going to be less or equal to zero, and therefore the output or the activation is going to be equal to zero. That's what's being shown right here. And on the other hand, if you happen to be on the left side of the line, then z is greater than zero, and the output or the activation is going to be equal to one. So that's what the perceptron is doing. It's behaving like a linear classifier. We have talked about linear classifiers before in the context of support vector machines. So linear because it's a straight line in two-dimensional space. So now let's take this one step further and make the assumption that the inputs are binary. So if the inputs are binary, zero or one, then there are only four possible inputs to the perceptron. You have 0, 0 right here. You have 1, 0, 0, 1, and 1, 1. Those are the four inputs. And based on these inputs, you know what the outputs are going to be. So let's take a look at that. Let's list all the inputs. 0, 0, that's going to give you a 1 as the output. 0, 1 gives you a 1. 1, 0 gives you a 1. And 1, 1 gives you a 0. So if you take a look at this carefully, this table right here, you see that what is being performed here by this perceptron is exactly what a NAND gate performs for you. So a perceptron, this particular perceptron, is equivalent to a NAND gate. And what's really remarkable about that is that we know that a NAND gate is a universal logic gate, which means that all the other gates that are familiar to us, such as a NOT gate, an AND gate, an OR gate, and a NOR gate, all of these can be constructed using one or more NAND gates. We know how to do this. And therefore, since a NAND gate can be implemented using a perceptron, perceptrons are universal for computation. What that really means is that if you give me any digital logic circuit, it doesn't matter how complex the circuit is. You give me any digital logic circuit which can be constructed from a variety of different gates, it can be implemented as a network of perceptrons. So let's take a look at a simple example of such a circuit. Let's say we're looking at a one-bit adder. So the digital logic circuit for a one-bit adder is the following. It has two inputs, x1 and x2, a series of NAND gates right here. And you have two outputs. One is the sum, which is the exclusive OR of x1 and x2. And the second is the carry bit, which is the AND of x1 and x2. These are the two outputs. So this we know from digital logic circuits. And since each one of these NAND gates can be represented using the perceptron we just talked about, we can simply create a perceptron network, which is exactly equivalent to this digital logic circuit.